Okay, so welcome to the talk of profile with Pauline. I basically submitted this talk because there were some people asking about RC, they would like better to understand how to use the talk. So that's why we are going to do some demonstrations. So I think most of you have heard about this about the Pauline tool, which is the error detector, which basically interprets the executable Dog program, and Codename is one of the tools from the complete setup. This one is for profiling, and what it basically does when it interprets the program, it basically traces and records how it's executed. So every time there is something called, it records it and it will give you a code graph and it will help you. Takes, and there is a counterpart which is the screen, which is the tool to visualize it. So so as a very basic demonstration, I created a very small program which has functions A and C which just spend some time. Here you have function B, which calls one of them 9 times, and they call one of the others, so obviously one of them will also have person. Will take 90% of the time, and the other will take just 10%. So if you run the tool and just have a look at the result, visualization has many views. So the ones which give you the most overview are the core map, which is just a graphic interpretation. So it's small really. So like if you have this is the small function. On the right you have the small function and here you have the bigger function. And here we have the representation which shows that the F function main, which spends like 4. You can read it, okay. You can read it, okay? Okay. So basically, it once calls function, I can't read it. It's A once calls function B, which 9 times calls function C, and here you can see in the visual representation that this is just a small part of your program and this is a large part of your program. And here you have other views, like this is the summary. This is the time that we just spend it. This is the inclusive cost, that's how much time it's spending in the function and everything it calls. And here that's just itself, which is spent in the function itself. So for example, here you can see that the vast majority of the program is in function C. And there are some functions that can show you as a relative for sparse seconds, so you can see that there's basically 90%, 10%. And there are some other interesting view, like you can see what calls each function. So for example, if we select B, you can see that it's called from main. We can inspect the source code, which also shows all this information. So here's the source code for B, and you can see that the vast majority of time spent in B is called in the call to C, and so on.
Sorry, what was the most bad part that you could see?
Yeah, so this part of the left is like a summary of all functions.
Yeah, but in that there is the setup which I think I understand and what's that include?
Like the self cost is just time that you spend in the function itself. Like what you see in the source code. And inclusive is that which is fed into the function and everything it calls recursively.
Ah, okay.
So, for example, if I would be to analyze where the time is spent, I will start somewhere at the top, at main, I can, for example, here is a list of everything it calls, and I can see that the cost of, what is this, B, that's time that's spent in B and everything it calls, which is basically usually the more interesting time. The self time is interesting only when you actually find something which will improve. Like, if something has big inclusive time, you want to go down and find something which has big self time, usually. Or other option is maybe something is called weight offer. So there are counts like how often is something called, maybe you want to optimize that it's not called so often. Yeah, so basically that's how the very basic stuff works. So just build a tree and go down and find less of the number of times to spend and see if you can maybe spend less time. There's one special catch with optimizing stuff, which is that it's often not just a simple tree. Sometimes you have complex structure, like you may have a function which is depending on some conditions. Here or call there, and even this one sometimes may call back. This, for example, can happen with like event dispatchers, neuro dispatcher can for example do it. Like there are many ways which enter and many ways which go out. And the point about profiling is that you usually get like the summary of the statistics. You don't get info for each call, but you have like info for a million calls, and you try to find out whether you can, in order of all, can make something call less. So, for example, if you would try to have inclusive cost of this function, it needs to include cost of this function, but this function needs to include cost of this function. So, kind of like the functions which should include each other. Doesn't work too well. So, for example, here I have modified some source which general maps this, and here I've used a condition for switching which way it will go. And yeah, like I just change depending on whether it's a random number. Sometimes coding is actually smart enough to. Yeah, so for example, here I tried it and you have A, which is calling B, which is calling C, which is calling B with number 2, and D. So, for example, the two most smart and it like other kind of unroll the loop. But in other cases, yeah, so in some other cases you can have strange loops. And then you can see that this file you spend 90% in it, which was something which also spends 90%, and there's something which costs 40% and doesn't add up. And there's something called cycle detection. The cache tool tries to if you enable it. Like here you can see that it's marked, there's something marked cyclone. It detected that there is a cyclone and it looks sometimes confusing in it, but this time another star adds up. Like if you have something calling to what place is the person part of. And basically what I often do about it, I actually turn off the cycle detection. If I see a cycle, then I just try to keep in mind that there is this cycle and it's necessary to be careful about adding this stuff up because, as I said, there is a cycle and you may be counting something many times over. Yeah, but it's actually very common, as I said. For example, I have a vision of something anyway, which is actually LibreOffice, which is a trace of LibreOffice code. And then, like, if you have the event loop, which calls to the GTK or Q event loop, it always is there. So you need to be careful about it. And also, same as example. One way how you can avoid this is if you actually trace just a part of the program. Like acid bugging, using this tool also takes a lot of time because the application runs very slowly. So what you can do, you can just enable the tracing for just specific parts. Or maybe you just call those specific parts. For example, if I look at how calculation in Calc works, I don't really want to profile or do a startup. I just don't care. So for example, either you can use some options, so you can zero everything entering some function and then you can dump it in a specific point, or you can even modify your application. You use some input files and then you have specific macros which will tell the tool to actually start and stop. So it is exactly the same program, but in the runs, it runs to the function, and I just tell it to start only before the function and after the function. And now, because it runs 10 times, I actually got 10 times, and if I look at them, yeah, so here we don't start at main, but only in the function where I started collecting, it goes down. And since I trace just one specific call for the function, I actually have just a line which shows me everything which was called in a specific run. Yes?
There's a similar set of pair of macros that start and stop count, just a counter, not instrumentation. And it seems that they're confusing a little bit, but from what I understand, instrumentation is something you can do at any point. And even on the command line, you can tell it to do it immediately or to not do it. But in most cases, what you really want is you want to instrument the part you're interested in and then control when to start actually counting and when to stop counting. And the reason you want that is because instrumentation has a much higher overhead and it doesn't give you the same results as instrument and then start count, stop count, start count, stop count, and then stop instrumentation. So it's something important to look into when you're trying to select it, profile it, to separate between instrumentation and counting. It's worth looking at the
instrumentation. Yeah, but actually myself don't use it, I just use it once, so that doesn't make a difference, but maybe. I've never tried it, so maybe.
start and stop instrumentation has a different behavior than just cut and start and stop comment.
Yeah, well, the main reason why it's just I want the other. I don't want the tool to waste time just analyzing something I don't care about. So I turn it off at the beginning, so it starts faster, and then I finish everything probably for parts I actually care about. So there was something like that. If you want to install a little bit LibreOffice, you can just set the variable, you can bring the arguments, so the usage is simple. As I said, it's slow, but it gives the results which you can just face off. And yeah, the important part is it's just a tool which shows you what's happened, but it doesn't really explain as much. So usually when you analyze something, you still need to understand the code or just learn to understand it as you go, because for example, if it shows you that you spent 80% somewhere, that doesn't really tell you if you can actually optimize it. Maybe just it's as fast as it can reasonably get, and it also doesn't tell you if you can improve the code, or maybe if you just can change the logic and like cut the number of calls to some place, like to half or maybe even more. So it's not a magic tool, nothing else. And so as a final demonstration, I have a choice which I actually did like a month ago or so. I don't know if it's readable from that far, but this was about opening and closing a specific document which I just wanted to trace. So the usual approach is just to start from main and go down and see where the cost goes. So if you start the main, you can go down, blah 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 blah. Exactly good. We are waiting for the event loop. And yeah, now we have the first cycle, which looks weird. As I said, that's event loop. Yeah, for example, here you can see that the cycle has like 20 million cycles, and the other numbers they don't add up because there's nothing. In this case, I'm going to turn it off simply. Which now shows me that there are two main paths. One of them is about opening the document, and the other one is about closing. So maybe I can go down the closing part, and if I go all the way down, like this just shows the interesting parts. It's not just that there is always one function called the other, but it strips away all the small parts, so it just moves down always the expensive parts. So if I go all the way down, here we close the count document, and if you go even down, we can see that there is SVT listener destructor, which ends listening, and it tries to remove stuff from a STL vector. And it's done like 200,000 times. It already moves from just one vector, so it spends a lot of time there. It's one of the possibilities how to optimize this specific call. And there is the other possibility, we can go down, and we are, this is the loading stuff, so you go down, there's nothing. thing. And here we enter the acceptable filter, which now has some weight. The most expensive is reading 4 glass. So you can still go down. And here we can see that quite a lot of time is spent in clearing, like dealing the red formulas, which is strange because it's actually import filter, so it shouldn't be deleting formulas all the time. And if I go down this way, go away, here is a lot of time spent allocating all the formula tokens and the clearing freezes again. So what was actually happening there was that if you call the import filter, read the formula, and then pass it to the local core, which made a copy of the formula. And then which needed an allocation, and then the filter simply deleted its formula. Instead of just passing the formula and everything allocated. So that also can be fixed. And of course, again, here is the rule that this is just a tool which tries to detect stuff. So, for example, it's possible that the tool, for example, doesn't quite measure everything properly. So I actually have a bug which fixes it. And the improvement is not as big as this shows, because I think just talking didn't measure properly the cost of allocation. But it has to find some stuff. And yeah, that's one of the practical interpretations. And basically, if you want to learn more, learn the way to just use the tool and find out for yourself what happens in real cases.